In our last episode, we discussed Spike happening to be a reflection of who he was or who he could have been through other characters. Well, Stray Dog Strut doesn't have any time for that. What we do get are plays on action movie tropes and the genre as a whole. What makes Cowboy Bebop so good as a series for its time has a lot to do with medium awareness. While there are a lot of aspects that have aged poorly, more on that in a second, there are still a lot of good takeaways. Anyway, let's begin. Our episode begins with a tall man of a dark complexion and afro, unwrapping bandages and staring at his own moving briefcase. A trio of henchmen in white lab coats, actually scientists, run into the bathroom with guns and surround him. They call him Abdul Hakim, and refuse to believe he's actually going to take them on when they have guns and he's unarmed. To which he takes them out unarmed and leaves with briefcase in hand. Hakim is shown to be at least a head and a half taller than them, and is an obvious reference to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, an NBA player whose first foray into action movies was alongside Bruce Lee. In Game of Death, Kareem plays a character named Hakim, who acts as the final boss, so to speak, to Bruce Lee's Billy Lowe. His fighting style in the movie is even meant to mirror Billy Lowe and Jeet Kune Do as a whole. Of course, you can see where we're going with this one. After the eye catch, we jump to the Bebop flying through a gate, showing us more on how gates work, before Spike slaps and then kicks the television monitor to get it to work. This is an excellent contrast of showing us once again how far technology has come, and yet has not. We get to the hosts of Big Shot, Punch and Judy, speaking to the 300,000 bounty hunters in the star system. Now, I'm not a mathematician, but given the explosive growth of human population and the settlement of many planets and moons, one can make an assumption that criminality is at an all-time high. We see that especially on Mars and other colonized planets, syndicates and other gangs run rampant. Ergo, the ISSP, having to deal with heavy corruption as is, opens work to bounty hunters. We then get to see Abdul Hakim pre-surgery and... Remember what I said about Cowboy Bebop having some aspects that have aged poorly? This would be one. So the word Negroid has a lot of attachments to racial science, long since debunked and made irrelevant. It, as well as words like Caucasoid, Mongoloid, and so on. The originator of these terms, Johann Friedrich Blumenbach, was a famous anthropologist, and in his time opposed slavery and believed in the equality of humankind as one race. However, in trying to categorize humans, well, things obviously are outdated with time, to say the least. Today's concept of equality could be inequality tomorrow as humans grow and understand. I guess one could make the argument that in this series, this continues to show that humanity as a whole is always two steps forward, one step back. A much easier explanation is that this was made in the late 90s, and Japan even now is woefully homogenous. The country has been taking baby steps in the last few years to open itself up as a country. Even then, even now, trickling would be the word. I digress. So Hakim stole a lab animal and is worth 8 million wulong. He's meant to be brought in alive, as being killed apparently means no bounty. Jet and Spike converse for a minute before they get a call from a doctor. How Jet or Spike know this doctor, I have no idea, but he happily gives them a head start to Hakim at a discounted price, and Spike beating the crap out of Hakim. This follows along with action movie tropes, the protagonist getting a hot tip, although Cowboy Bebop does lean on this, and the same argument can be made for detective noir on the whole. We cut to the Bebop landing, and then find Hakim talking on the phone, likely with the person he has a dog in the briefcase for. We get a reference to Enter the Dragon, considered one of the greatest martial arts movies of all time. Hakim has a giant golden dragon behind him. And of course, while Hakim's height and style are inspired by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's character, his afro is more inspired by Jim Kelly from the titular movie. While Doc continues to inform Spike and Jet about what exactly Hakim is carrying, we get Hakim in what looks like to be a cafe, having an exchange about various sodas, hei soy, and lao chu. Considering the various signs, Cantonese, language bits, and so on, the city seems to have Chinese roots. One of the grifters in the cafe tries to pull a fast one and gets the crap kicked out of him, and fed a roach. Another thief in cahoots steals from Hakim. He sneaks away on a garbage truck, and Hakim proceeds to punch a roasted pig in frustration. Our would-be thief meanwhile realizes he has a dog. Spike goes through various connections, finally landing at a pawn shop. He and the pawn shop owner make conversation about information Spike can find, and here we get another reference. The nunchucks that Spike picks up look like a version of those that Bruce Lee infamously used in the movie. Spike and the owner geek out about it for a second, and the pawn shop owner gives up some more info. Meanwhile, we cut to said pet shop Spike has been sent to, in which the thief is trying to offer up the dog. Spike confuses the thief who stole from Hakim for Hakim, and we get a bit of a standoff. We then finally get to see what's in the case, a MacGuffin, so to speak, in this case a Welsh Corgi. Spike, being no fan of dogs, and finding out that said dog is common, decides to just leave well enough alone, until Hakim comes to get his briefcase, by which I mean iron back. A MacGuffin is often a literary device in which the protagonist and other forces within a story chase after. It usually serves no other purpose besides being something that the story is framed around, oftentimes meant to distract or prop up the idea behind the story as a whole. Consider the briefcase from Pulp Fiction, the statue from the Maltese Falcon, or the Chinese consul's daughter from Rush Hour. What comes next is one of the best chase scenes in the series, very much akin to a typical action movie. Want It All Back by Yoko Kanno and the Seatbelts plays, and we have a three-way chase going, complete with a car crash, slapstick, and parallel running that breaks out into a standoff. Spike and Hakim finally scrape, and apparently we're meant to take away that they're more or less even in a fight. At least until a barge comes by, and we end up with Hakim taking a dip in a lobster tank, and Spike getting iron in the water. Jet seems to be happy to welcome the dog, while Spike is just pissed off about the dog being worthless. Spike mentions hating kids and pets, and he'll soon add women with attitudes on that list. Just give it an episode. Meanwhile, Hakim emerges from the water, sees two kids, asks one of them the current time, and then knocks them both down. We get a brief scene from the scientists who want iron, pretty much playing up as being vague as possible because, after all, the dog is a MacGuffin. A common trope of action movies are often scientists who want to get their hands on one thing or another, whether or not they were the ones who lost it in the first place. This is just fulfilling that. Back to Spike and Jet with some banter, and then Hakim using a code SNOOP to get in touch with contacts, because, you know, Snoop Dogg. Hakim's buyer breaks it off with him for taking too long, and we never get to find out who he planned on selling iron to. Hakim runs into a fortune teller who uses a bird to tell the future, and Hakim humors the idea. While Spike complains about Jet's plan to use the dog as bait, the scientists go after Ayn using a radar-driven whistle that drives all the animals in the city to go crazy, especially the dogs. The fortune teller, who's apparently the real deal, tells Hakim that what he's after is here and now, just as Spike chasing Ayn, chasing the scientist van, passes behind him. Cue another chase scene with more slapstick, including Hakim punching out a groom, trying to run down Spike, and grabbing Ayn. Spike chases after Hakim in the swordfish, the scientists chase after Hakim in a van, and Spike tries to vertically ram Hakim. We learn that Ayn can't drive stick, or whatever constitutes for stick in the year 2077. Spike, in a moment of empathy, once Ayn jumps out of Hakim's vehicle, catches the dog, while Hakim and the scientists crash into a police station from off the highway. Later, Punch and Judy tell us what Ayn is, more or less, while the two thieves who worked over Hakim now clean up the pet shop. While this episode has many trappings of a modern action movie, including chase scenes with minor slapstick, MacGuffins, and multiple parties all working against each other, Stray Dog Strut ends up as a, get ready for this one, a shaggy dog story. No one got what they wanted, everyone expended time and energy trying to get it, and nothing was accomplished. Jet and Spike get no reward and accomplish little of nothing. Hakim never meets his contact, meaning he stole Ayn for nothing and got arrested. The scientists never get their top secret data dog back, they never get revenge on Hakim, and they go to prison anyway. No one got what they wanted. A shaggy dog story is often a story with a non-ending, or effectively a story that goes nowhere. Sometimes this is used in humor, but for the most part ends in complete irrelevance. I suppose one could argue that this episode ending as a shaggy dog story is also tying a ribbon on the whole ode to modern action movies. Game of Death, for example, ends entirely like this. Bruce Lee's character never goes up to the final level of the pagoda, despite being all the martial artists. We never find out what happens to his brother or sister, or if Lee's character deals with their kidnappers that force him to go up to the pagoda. This ending is what has made sense of Lee's original vision for the movie, though of that we shall truly never know. The footage cobbled together effectively makes Bruce Lee's final action movie a shaggy dog story, chasing after a MacGuffin in the form of a location. What we do know is this episode of Cowboy Bebop was sort of an affectionate love letter, or parody depending on how you take it, on action movies as a whole, and one of the greatest action stars of all time. That's all I have for now, I have no idea what I'm really doing, and we'll come back for session 3, Honky Tonk Women. See you, Space Cowboy.